Belief and Technique for Modern Prose by Jack Kerouac. List of essentials. 1. Scribbled secret notebooks and wild typewritten pages for your own joy. 2. Submissive to everything, open, listening. 3. Try never get drunk outside your own house. 4. Be in love with your life. 5. Something that you feel will find its own form. 6. Be crazy, dumb saint of the mind. 7. Blow as deep as you want to blow. 8. Write what you want, bottomless, from bottom of the mind. 9. The unspeakable visions of the individual.
I have no precise memory of writing the notes which have been published under the title Naked Lunch. The title was suggested by Jack Kerouac. The title means exactly what the words say, naked lunch, a frozen moment when everyone sees what is on the end of every fork. On stools covered in white satin sit naked mugwumps, sucking translucent colored syrups through alabaster straws. Mugwumps have no liver and nourish themselves exclusively on sweets. These creatures secrete an addicting fluid through their erect penises, which prolongs life by slowing metabolism.
Who cowered in unshaven rooms and underwear, burning their money in waste baskets and listening to the terror through the wall. Who got busted in their pubic beards, returning through Laredo with a belt of marijuana for New York. Who ate fire in paint hotels or drank turpentine in Paradise Alley, death or purgatory, their torsos night after night, with dreams, with drugs, with waking nightmares.
We're at Columbia University now, and the connection here with the Beats is that this is where Jack Kerouac and Allen Ginsberg met, and the catalytic reaction began that became the Beat movement, and that was one of the forces that helped create and I think shape the movements of the 1960s. Now, Kerouac comes down from your own fair state of Massachusetts, from Lowell. He's a working class guy. From a very early age, is interested in writing. He is a great football player at Lowell's, and they offered him a football scholarship. The man who shook up America with the Beat movement was basically began as a jock until he hurts his leg. And at that point, he meets Allen Ginsberg from Paterson, New Jersey, father, high school teacher, poet of minor note. And they're not talking too much about football. I was traveling west one time at the junction of the state line of Colorado, its arid western one, and the state line of poor Utah. I saw in the clouds, huge and massed above the fiery golden desert of Evenfall, the great image of God with forefinger pointed straight at me through halos and rolls and gold folds that were like the existence of a gleaming spear in his right hand, which saith, come on, boy, go thou across the ground. Go moan for man. Go moan. Go groan, go groan alone, go roll your bones alone. Go thou and be little beneath my sight. Go thou and be minute as seed in the pod. Go thou, die hence. And of this world report you well and truly.
We weren't trying to make a social revolution particularly. We were just trying to propose our own souls to ourselves.
Were they lovers?
We felt very close to each other, just intuitively. But, you know, without any overt sexual thing, except that I was in love with him. I had a crush on him, I had a crush on everybody.
They found African-American culture fascinating. They related to weird people like William Burroughs.
Jack and I went out to investigate your soul. We both really thought you were real interesting and dignified and weird, but intelligent. Jack said, Bill's the most intelligent man in America.
They take a lot of drugs.
Do they take a lot of drugs?
Cannabis, datura, coca.
I had a habit, ma'am. Kept me occupied.
Burroughs began exploring Times Square. I said, to see the lumpen population. He was interested in the different varieties of the bars. He met Herbert Hunky, and Hunky was living around Times Square, practically on the street.
They come strolling down the street with books under their arms.
We thought you had some kind of secret knowledge.
Just good, healthy activity in a funny way.
We'd pick up some grass smoke and observe the phenomena of the red light over the roof cones of the buildings that indicated some kind of apocalyptic end of millennium consciousness.
These are all justifications.
For what?
For an interest in the whole
thing.
Sometimes you lose sight of the fact that these were basically college kids, except for Burroughs, who was a little older. These were basically young people who were kind of broken off in public, in a way. They were all getting loaded, and they were just making a lot of conversation that they could build off.
Does that in my poem about the Empire State Building that had not doomed the dumb eyes of New York all the time?
Yeah, it's pretty good. I've got a new poem, too. Now all these poets, struggling to be poets. Same time, if they want to, they turn over their little purple moonlight pages in which their secret naked doodlings do show. Secret scatological thought. And that's why everybody wants to see it.
America, I've given you all, and now I'm nothing. America, I used to be a communist when I was a kid. I'm not sorry. I smoke marijuana every chance I get. Whenever I go to Chinatown, I get drunk and never get laid. My mind is made up. There's going to be trouble.
I have told you that I will offer my beliefs, my affiliations, and everything else to the American public, and they will know where I stand, as they do from what I have written.
Stand away from the stand.
I have written for Americanism for many years, and I shall
stand away from the stand.
Fight for the Bill of Rights, which you are trying to destroy.
3 years or so after the end of the war, the draft is back. The Korean War then in the early 50s. The McCarthy hearings, the House Un-American Activities Committee, the execution of the Rosenbergs, the sense of a status quo, business as usual, a kind of stolid, even comfort.
That it's the fattest civilization around, the best ever. And in reality, there was an incredible provincialism and a very strong sense of conformity and a stultifying feeling that you had to get along with Life magazine, as you know what Ginsberg says. I don't want my emotional life to be read by Time.
Eisenhower's intention was that we should try to settle down to some nice, quiet American pursuits and not rock the boat. And it was time for us to ease off a bit. He accomplished that. The country was pretty quiet.
We ask every citizen to immediately report any information regarding espionage, sabotage, or un-American activities to the Federal Bureau of Investigation.
And that made him such a flop, was he beat, or when he should have bopped.
It was such a schizophrenic distinction between the private world of what everybody knew and talked about, like black culture or teahead culture of those years, or just sexual culture or gay culture. There were all these marginalized cultures which were never represented in public.
It was friendship, affairs, intermarriage, and a sense of a community. They were the jazz musicians, and they were related to the abstract expressionists.
There was a joy and an optimism. The music reflected that. Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie were breaking down those walls.
It's all insane. Then you look back, you look away, around. Everything is coming in from everywhere in the sound of the jazz.
Hi! Hey!
We were our own audience. I mean, Kerouac wrote 7 books, or 14 books before they were published.
We were more or less united, I would say. Sports increased awareness, increased freedom.
Dostoevsky's Notes from the Underground is the model of a lot of these people, the guy who lives in some kind of hole and rails at what's going on around him. Many of us, without knowing Dostoevsky, thought that was our role.
Alan had this vision, these bright visions, And he suddenly said, we're taking over the universe.
C'est vous qui l'avez inventé, ce terme-là. Beat Generation.
J'ai entendu des vieux bonhommes dire ça. Des vieux nègres.
Oui. Dans le sens de écrasé, vaincu.
Oui. Pauvre.
Pauvre.
Béatitude.
Punky gave it as one I would usually give it. If somebody wants to tell you their problem and all that, he said, not now, man, I'm beat.
When the Sputnik went up, he said, oh, these guys are out of this world. Beat Nicks.
Met Mr. Ginsberg maybe about 2 months after I had left prison. 1949?
You said 50.
It's at the beginning of 1950, but I'm sorry for one fucking little mistake. Stay out of it.
Women were pretty much ornaments for the men and the beats, and they were the caretakers.
They got away with murder because what they were proselytizing produced the male artist hero. And there was a look all the women had, a certain look. It was hard to tell them from each other.
I don't think we were particularly machismo. Actually, Burroughs and I were queer, very sensitive and literary.
Well, some of our best friends are women.
Most of them were gay, except Jack. Now, Jack had a tough time with women in a way. Even I got in trouble with him, and he got very unhappy that I fucked his girl. But that was the time when I did not know Jack. I was just introduced to him. It wasn't as if I fucked my best friend's girl.
It's the beat generation. It's Bayat. It's the beat to keep. It's the beat of the heart. It's being beat and down in the world and like old-time lowdown. And like in ancient civilizations, the slave boatmen rowing galleys to a beat.
We didn't expect to be represented in public. We just wanted to represent ourselves and write for heaven, you know, building up treasures in heaven. I think Kerouac despaired of ever having his work published.
I read the book, and I was simply stunned. I said then, I believe, that it was as perfect an expression of a generation as Hemingway's The Sun Also Rises.
Kerouac was a writer. That is, he wrote. The difference being a bullfighter who fights a bull is different from a bullshitter who makes passes with no bull there.
Life magazine came around to interview us for an article on the Beat Generation. And I thought, Jesus, if they think that we have anything to say, they must be scraping the bottom of the barrel. They must be pretty desperate.
Jack told me a little earlier he was nervous. Are you nervous now? No? Good. Jack, got a couple of square questions, but I think the answer would be interesting. How long did it take you to write On the Road?
3 weeks.
3 weeks? Jeez, that's amazing. How long were you on the road itself?
7 years.
7 years. Yeah, I was on the road once for 3 weeks, and it took me 7 years to write about it. Well, the other way around. I've heard that you write so fast that you don't like to use regular typing paper, but instead you prefer to use one big, long roll of paper. Is that true?
Yeah. When I write narrative novels, I don't want to change my narrative thought. I keep going.
Wonderful part of Jack's On the Road was when he said, our battered suitcases were piled on the sidewalk again. We had longer ways to go, but no matter, the road is life.
I'd often dreamed of going west to see the country, always vaguely planning and never taking off. I left with my canvas bag and took off for the Pacific Ocean.
The whole nation was tilting westward. It was like a drink that had been stirred with the Second World War, and it hadn't settled down yet.
Somewhere along the line, I knew there'd be girls, visions, everything. Somewhere along the line, the pearl would be handed to me.
There's just nothing like being out on an American road. You get outside, something happens to you, and when you're traveling through outside, the wind goes over the top of your head, and you get a static charge. You'll see people with their hair standing on end like this who've been driving a long time, and their eyes kind of wild. It's a high.
Hey,
arrived at Council Bluffs at dawn. All winter I'd been reading the great wagon parties that held council there. And of course, now it was only cute suburban cottages all laid out in the dismal gray dawn. Then Omaha, and by God, the first cowboy I saw in a 10-gallon hat and Texas boots. Looked like any beat character the brick-walled dawns of the East, except for the ghetto.
America, this is quite serious. America, this is the impression I get from looking in the television set. America, is this correct? It's true, I don't want to join the army or turn lathes and precision parts factories. I'm nearsighted and psychopathic anyway. America, I'm putting my queer shoulder to the wheel.
And away we go!
Into the interior. A vast subdivision antennae of television to the meaningless sky. In life-proof houses, they hover over the young. Sop up a little of what they shut out. Only the young bring anything in, and they are not young very long.
Just ahead, over the rolling wheat fields, all gold beneath the distant snows of Estes, I'd be seeing old Denver at last. There were smokestacks, smoke, rail yards, red brick buildings, and the distant downtown gray stone. I stumbled along with the most wicked grin of joy in the world among the old bums and beat cowboys. I felt like an arrow that could shoot out all the way.
A high tower on a wide plain. If you climb up one floor, you'll see 1,000 miles of water.
Right over those knolls over there, something wonderful is going to be. But you found out the more you went, there was just more knolls.
So, in America, when the sun goes down, and I sit on the old broken down river pier watching the long, long skies over New Jersey, and sense all that raw land that rolls in one unbelievable huge bulge over to the West Coast, and all that road going. Think of Dean Moriarty, or even think of old Dean Moriarty, the father we never found. Think of Dean Moriarty, I think of Dean Moriarty.
Well, I don't think there is any real Neo. Kerouac, I think, had a sort of an idealized figure of Neo as this on-the-road character. I mean, he's sort of the on-the-road personified.
He was such an overwhelming trip. Cassidy, I don't know. I it's hard to even know what to say about Cassidy. He was so singular. He was the first person I met who he himself was the art. A lot of people thought he was crazy, you know, a lot of people were afraid of him, and most people I know didn't understand him at all, you know. But he was like a musician.
He was like Charlie Mingus. He played the bass line. Whatever else happened was happening around his bass line, and he used the gearship and the bass line, kind of going like the turn bass.
No one was there, but I waved anyhow, huh? All right, see you, Keith.
Cassidy was a sort of self-taught prison boy who came here to New York to go con Kerouac into teaching him how to write.
He was a great driver.
He's always behind him.
And I don't mean a fast driver, I mean a great driver. His page was this highway, and that his writing tool was one of these cars.
All right, here we go. One-handed delight. No, that's masturbating. No.
Nothing in the world he liked better than getting about six scared kids in the car and bring them back about 3 days later, and their eyes looked like fried bolts.
His special thing was that he could remember the chain of thought that went before that led up to a moment of conversation.
Come in here yesterday and jumped and jittery around, and so it looked like I was high, so I just let people think I was high. Everybody has forms, and everything's known, and the forms are changing. There's no life in the forms.
And just his whole body language and everything was so communicative. It was just amazing.
It's already too late. The Pentagon has taken care of all that. We're doing this deliberately, as far as that goes.
The Pentagon is doing what deliberately?
Well, I don't know who's running the country, do you? Open up.
We began rolling in the foothills before Oakland and saw stretched out ahead of us the fabulous white city of San Francisco. No more land, yelled Dean. Can't go no further because there ain't no more land.
The war displaced everyone, and they didn't go back home. It was a little like after any war, and it was certainly like after the Civil War when people like Mark Twain were displaced and ended up in San Francisco. He was a carpetbagger in the way, just like the East Coast beats were all carpetbaggers, including myself. We're in the tradition of dissidents. So we started City Lights. The idea was to create a literary meeting place.
There was already cultivated a San Francisco Renaissance. There always was a anarchist, pacifist, anti-Stalinist, anti-authoritarian, literary, bohemian, anti-war circle.
People who want to be themselves, basically. People who want to remain true to their very being. People who don't want to play the game. People who want to be whatever they are.
And that manifested itself in literature and painting, in bohemian parties, poetry readings.
I would go into a macho bar and jump on the pool table and read some poems. Now, either I got beat up or I made $50. Most of the times I made $50. It was a cold night in the big city where love is the roar and death is the beat, and I yelled like a madman at the top of my voice. Everybody sing, everybody sing. And I started to sing the song about pretty flowers, and then the men in their white coats came with their jackets, and I told them to sing also. Let's sing a song, let's sing a song. And they took me away, away, away from the roar and the beat. The beat, let's sing
a song. Rex Roth had been invited to organize a reading at the Six Gallery. He suggested to McClure or myself that we organize it, and it fell to me. And Rex Roth gave me Gary Snyder's address. Snyder was a student studying Chinese, Japanese, and Zen.
Alan and I lined up that space with the idea of holding a reading for our various relatively unpublished friends.
What we were interested in was our own writing and talking with people who were also trying to write and paint and whatever else, and trying to get our way someplace else, or get a new start that would gently replace a lot of this slobber.
I followed the whole gang of howling poets to the reading at Gallery 6 that night, which was, among other important things, the night of the birth of the San Francisco Poetry Renaissance. Scores of people stood around in the darkened gallery, straining to hear every word of the amazing poetry reading as I wandered from group to group, urging them to glug a slug from the jug, or wandered back and sat on the right side of the stage, giving out little wows and guesses of approval.
Heaven was only half as far that night, listening to the burnt phrases, when I heard the poet have a rhyming erection.
I was there, and the next morning I sent a telegram to Allen Ginsberg saying, I greet you at the beginning of a great career. When do we get the manuscript?
I had a conversation with Rex Roth the next day. I said, oh, gee, I'm going to be famous in San Francisco or North Beach. And he said, you're going to be famous from bridge to bridge.
The first edition was printed in England. It was seized by the U.S. Customs in San Francisco. All during the trial, we were still selling it. But we never took the book out of the window.
There were a series of trials in the late 50s that liberated the word, and that meant a whole spiritual liberation after that.
It's really hard to get that kind of publicity.
I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness, starving, hysterical, naked.
Angel-headed hipsters burning for the ancient heavenly connection to the starry dynamo in the machinery of night. Well, poverty and tatters and hollow-eyed and high sat up smoking in the supernatural darkness of cold water flats,
floating across the tops of cities, contemplating jazz. Who cowered in unshaven rooms and underwear, burning their money in waste baskets and listening to the terror through the wall. Who got busted in their pubic beards, returning through Laredo with a belt of marijuana for New York. Who ate fire in paint hotels or drank turpentine in Paradise Alley. Death or purgatory, their torsos night after night, with dreams, with drugs, with waking nightmares. Peyote solidities of walls, green trees, cemetery dawns, white drunkenness over the rooftops, storefront Burroughs, T-head, joyride, neon blinking traffic light, sun, the moon and tree vibrations in the roaring winter dusks. Who talk continuously 70 hours from park to pad to bar to Bellevue to museum to the Brooklyn Bridge, a lost battalion of platonic conversationalists jumping down the stoops, off fire escapes, off windowsills, off the Empire State, out of the moon. Yakety yakketing, screaming, vomiting, whispering facts and memories and anecdotes and eyeball kicks and shocks of hospitals and jails and wars. Who loaned it through the streets of Idaho, seeking visionary Indian angels, who were visionary Indian angels, who howled on their knees in the subway and were dragged off the roof waving genitals and manuscripts. Who wandered around and around at midnight in the railroad yard, wondering where to go, and went, leaving no broken hearts. Who lit cigarettes in boxcars, 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 racketing through snow toward lonesome farms and grandfather night, and rose reincarnate in the ghostly clothes of jazz and the gold horn shadow of the band. Carl Sullivan, I'm with you in Rockland, where you're madder than I am. I'm with you in Rockland, where we wake up electrified out of the coma by our own souls. Airplanes roaring over the roof, they've come to drop angelic bombs. The hospital illuminates itself. Imaginary walls collapse. Oh, skinny legions run outside. Oh, starry spangled shock of mercy. The eternal war is here. Oh, victory! Forget your underwear! We're free! I'm with you in Rockland. In my dreams, you walk dripping from a sea journey on the highway across America in tears to the door of my cottage in the western night.
I had no idea that it would be famous. No idea that it was of such value to other people. Apparently it was.
Dear Alan, there is an end of the world feeling in Tangier with his glut of nylon shirts, Swiss watches, scotch, and sex. The whole town is a trap. You will see it closing, but there will be no escape, no place to go.
The wayward wind is a restless wind, a restless wind. The next of kin to the wayward wind. In a lonely shack by a railroad track, he spends.
Dear Alan, Mexico is home to me, and I can't go there.
Made him a slave to his wandering ways.
Got a letter from my lawyer. I am sentenced in absentia.
I think
the bill, I'll shoot that off my head.
I knew that the ugly spirit, which is always the worst part of everyone's character, would take over and that something awful would happen. Just an absolute piece of insanity.
It was then that he began writing.
Who are you?
I'm Bill. Who are you?
I'm Tony. Where are you, Bill?
I'm in a 1920 movie, Tony.
Who are you? I'm Tony. Who are you?
I'm Bill. I was born February 5, 1914 in St. Louis, Missouri.
So I was sort of a wasp washout.
We will not listen to you. We have had enough of your con and bullshit.
I left the United States because of some trouble.
My whole life has been resistance to the ugly spirit. Live with it day and night.
Not anticipating any trouble because I don't like violence.
There is no thing to fear. There is no thing.
He's probably the only guy I know who was really just full-out junkie who managed to come back, kick it in the sore. Very rare.
There's all kinds of addictions. Power is one of the principal addictions. But when they got the power, they look sleek, satisfied. They're getting it steady.
Thou shalt not blow pot smoke into the face of thy pet.
He could punch a typewriter or he could punch a tape recorder to death in shorter time than any man that I've ever known. He had such enormous energy in those days and such enormous intention behind what he was doing.
Take the enclosed copy of this letter, cut along the lines, rearrange, putting section 1 by section 3 and section 2 by section 4. You will hear my voice. Brian had made these cut-ups of various magazines. First cut-ups were very, very funny. Then it wasn't so funny anymore. Life is a cut-up. Every time you look out the window, when you walk down the street, you're continually being cut by random factors. This is a fact of human perception, and the cut-up simply made this explicit. How does it seem to you now?
How does it seem to you now?
Thank you.
Good.
Look at that.
Thank you.
Surrealism is a kind of automatic writing. Rambeau's phrase was a systematic derangement of the senses, and the idea being that the senses are to some extent ideological, formed by external pressures.
Showers, open fire.
And so you shatter that, break it up. Drugs, extreme experiences, kinky sex.
In fact, the official definition of surrealism is to make a work without any a priori moral or aesthetic considerations.
Blast of trumpets. The man wriggles. His flesh turns to viscid, transparent jelly that drifts away in green mist. Unveiling a monster black centipede. Waves of unknown stench fill the room, searing the lungs, grabbing the stomach.
Over a series of years, from 53 to 57, Burroughs sent me the letters with all the chapters or routines of Naked Lunch. And then by 57, there was so much material that I had and he had that it was time for me to leave San Francisco and work on it with him to shape it into a book. Kerouac had started the typing. We arrived with all this new material, shuffled it around, typed it up.
We had about 500 pages of notes. So Brian Geisen and Sinclair Bayless, I sat down and assembled this. The chapter went to the printer. We said we'll figure out the order later, but when I came back from the printer, we took one look and said there's no necessity to make any changes. There's certain requirements. If someone can't stand hours, years of solitude, sitting in a chair alone in a room, he should look for another trade, I think.
I tried to read Naked Lunch. I read halfway through it, and I pitched it. It didn't make much sense to me. It just sort of disgusts me.
Thou shalt not be such a shit you don't know you are one.
Mr. Burroughs, do you regret anything in your life?
I have no precise memory of writing the notes which have been published under the title Naked Lunch. The title was suggested by Jack Kerouac. The title means exactly what the words say, Naked Lunch, a frozen moment. When everyone sees what is on the end of every fork. I can feel the heat closing in. I feel them out there making their moves, setting up their devil doll stool pigeons, crooning over my spoon and dropper I throw away at Washington Square Station. Vault a turnstile, two flights down the iron stairs, catch an uptown A train. Young, good-looking, crew-cut, Ivy League advertising-type fruit holds the door back for me. I'm evidently his idea of a character. You know the type. He comes on with bartenders and cab drivers talking about right hooks and the Dodgers. Call the counterman a knee-dix by his first name, a real asshole. And right on time, this narcotics dick in the white trench coat. Now imagine, tailing somebody in a white trench coat. Trying to pass as a fag, I guess? I can hear the way he would say it. Holding my outfit in his left hand, right hand on his piece. I think you dropped something, fella. But the subway is moving. They call me the exterminator. At one brief point of intersection, I did exercise that function and witnessed the belly dance of roaches suffocating in yellow pyrethium powder. My present assignment, find the live ones and exterminate. Not the bodies, but the moles, you understand? But I forget, you cannot understand. The meat cafe occupies one side of the plaza. It's a maze of kitchens, restaurants, sleeping cubicles, perilous iron balconies and basements opening into the underground baths. On stools, covered in white satin, sit naked mugwumps, sucking translucent colored syrups through alabaster straws. Mugwumps have no liver and nourish themselves exclusively on sweets. These creatures secrete an addicting fluid through their erect penises, which prolongs life by slowing metabolism. Boat whistle, foghorn, skyrocket burst over oily lagoons. Penny arcade open into a maze of dirty pictures. Ceremonial cannon. Boom in the harbor. A scream shoots down a white hospital corridor, out along a wide, dusty street between palm trees. Whistles out across the desert like a bullet. 1,000 boys come at once in outhouses, bleak public school toilets, attics, basements, tree houses, Ferris wheels, deserted houses, limestone caves, rowboats, garages, barns, rubbly, windy city outskirts behind mud walls, smell of dried excrement, black dust blowing over lean copper bodies. Coming over a hill of rusty iron, we meet a group of natives. We throw gasoline on them and light it. White flash, mangled insect screams. I woke up with a taste of metal in my mouth, back from the dead, trailing the colorless death smell. No, no more, no moss. Tangier, 1959.
Dear Alan, made connection with the unassuming little witch doctor who prepared me some yahe. It is the most powerful drug I have ever experienced. That is, it produces the most complete derangement of the senses. I felt, you know, so pulling together like that. Horrible feeling, horrible feeling.
Why do you put yourself through all that torture?
What are you talking about? You want to take your hay, you take your hay.
Smoking hashish and sniffing cocaine. It struck as being a very glamorous and easy life. Little did I know.
I would have never written Cuckoo's Nest without LSD.
I think a lot of that stuff that was written by all of these guys would never have happened if they'd have just stayed on the get up early in the morning and drink a lot of coffee and do what you can.
What might be a negative experience for someone else can be a very positive experience for a writer. The damage to health from addiction is minimal.
But it has done things to your soul.
That was my protector. There was something that loved me and I loved and I wanted, and there it was.
If we want to discourage use of LSD for altering our attitudes, we'll have to encourage such changes in our society that nobody will need it to break through to common sympathy.
It is, in effect, instant insanity.
You've got a much better chance of walking from a murder than a drug charge.
There are a lot of drugs I don't use more than once a year. I try to take every illegal drug once a year. That's like a Catholic does that, but no big deal.
So Gregory Corso went to Paris. Burroughs stayed in Tangiers in Paris. Kerouac became more retired at home after having a great deal of venom and mockery laid on him. Peter Orlovsky and I disappeared into India, basically. Went around the world and stayed away for 3 years and studied something new.
I was never really heavy into Buddhism. Get Allen Ginsberg to talk about that. He can go on and on and on.
If I can have your heart, if I can have your prayers, if the good Lord is willing, I will continue to try to lead this nation and this world to peace.
By the time I got back in 63, war was raging already. And rather than being sort of enlightened by the possibility of some open world, was trying to inflict a Catholic dictator on the Buddhist Vietnamese. Heavy metal thunder.
React to what?
React to the greatness of the march of the day and the victory or what? You happy with it?
Hari Om Namo Shiva.
We were beatniks, we reveled in it, we never called each other beatniks. Then all of a sudden, in late 1966, early 67, Ginsberg and Gary Snyder and others organized this big, huge be-in in San Francisco. And right after the be-in, all of a sudden you were no longer beatnik. You were a hippie.
What is your whole attitude to life? And when you meet somebody, what is your attitude towards them?
I don't like them.
You don't?
No.
I think that the Vietnamese war is nothing but a plot between the North Vietnamese and the South Vietnamese, who are cousins, to get jeeps in the country.
They're not very good plotters, are they?
Well, they got a lot of jeeps.
We were rebelling against a kind of rigidity in the culture, and the Beats seemed to point out that there were lots of room in the U.S. Constitution for more freedom.
We are going to Chicago, about 250,000 of young, energetic love buddies, to engage in a youth international party, sing in, grope in, love in.
Which is really heightened is a consciousness which takes action.
Are you expecting trouble?
We expect to march.
We
expect trouble all the time.
The policeman isn't there to create disorder. The policeman is there to preserve disorder.
The Beats were originally non-political. Others who were political were really following the Beat movement to its logical conclusion.
He was wonderful.
He was an honored presence.
When the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart, that you can't take part.
I always thought that what we were doing was a patriotic act. who has always been out there, old crazy coots that keep out on the edge of where civilization is gone. I think a lot of this comes from Cassidy and from Kerouac. Cassidy was our driver. He knew that this was going to be the best stage he was ever going to have to do his number. Never mind all that reflection. Let's see who we are. Let's turn the thing on as bright as it'll go and then see what kind of shadow we cast.
I put my back toward the screen and then spun and let the momentum carry the panel through the screen and window with a ripping crash. The glass splashed out in the moon like a bright, cold water baptizing the sleeping earth. I put my hand on the sill and vaulted after the panel into the moonlight.
Casey, do you feel that you have the right to do what you want, whatever you want, and still live in this world?
I feel a man has the right to be as big as he feels it in him to be.
He wasn't destined to grow old. He was always young, and he always will be. 100 years ago, he would have been on a horse, but his hot rod was his horse.
Delicate eyes that blinked blue Rockies all ash. Nipples, ribs I touched with my thumb or ash. Mouth my tongue touched once or twice, all ash. Our existence is so brief, as we understood it, that it becomes more poignant, more emotionally rich, knowing that it's like a dream that is already finished, as Kerouac once said. Life is a dream already over.
Jack suddenly one morning had a hemorrhage. Apparently brought on by years and years of consuming alcohol, which I guess is the typical alcoholic's death.
America by his day was sick. Hard-heartedness had taken over. So I would say America broke his heart.
You just have to read the reviews of his books in those days. You know, he was put down. It was as a, you know, like knifed and. And yet he was writing about enthusiasm and delight, and he was being treated like some juvenile delinquent.
Now, Jack, Mr. Kerouac, to what extent do you believe that the Beat generation is related to the hippies?
Well,
what do they have in common? Was this an evolution from the one to the other?
It's just the older ones.
Yeah.
See, I'm 46 years old. These kids are 18. It's the same movement, which is apparently some kind of Dionysian movement in late civilization, in which I did not intend any more than I suppose Dionysius did, or whatever his name was.
Hey, that was good, wasn't it?
Good all the time, boy.
Give that man a drink.
Spent all the night with poets and so on. He drank and all that. And, well, I said, aren't you afraid of hell? He says, oh, no. He says, I'm concerned with heaven. He says, I'm thinking about heaven all the time. I want to see Gerard, my little brother.
He'd already scribed 1,000 dreams, 1,000 pages of Dharma, 1,000,000 words that sounded like 1,000,000 ears. His heart was tender. He'd already died and become recording angel.
C'est vous qui devez inventer ce terme-là, Beat Generation.
J'ai entendu des vieux bonhommes dire ça, ben, su, des vieux nègres.
Oui. Dans le sens de écraser, vaincu.
Oui, pauvre.
Pauvre.
Après ça, j'ai été dans la petite église de Saint-Jean d'Arc. D'un coup, j'ai dit, ah, beat,
béatitude.
Jack Kerouac, the novelist who wrote On the Road, reached the end of it today. The 47-year-old spokesman for the Beat Generation died of a massive hemorrhage in a St. Petersburg, Florida hospital.
All my thoughts of you. all the people that leave this stuff here. It's their way. You know, it's their way of coming here. It's part of their path, you know. It's like 13-year-old kids, college kids, guys my age, old-timers. Wicked spectrum.
So, that's what's gonna happen to you?
No, I'm gonna be in an unmarked grave.
What do you think Jack would have felt about all this? All this stuff?
Yeah, he would have grooved on this stuff. Why? Because this stuff comes from the heart, and that's where he was coming from.
I believe in order, tenderness, and piety.
Well, then your point was that a movement which you conceived as relatively pure has become ideologized.
No, a movement that was considered what?
Pure.
Yes, it was pure in my heart.
Don't explain.
Belief and Technique for Modern Prose by Jack Kerouac. List of essentials. 1. Scribbled secret notebooks and wild typewritten pages for your own joy. 2. Submissive to everything, open, listening. 3. Try and never get drunk outside your own house. 4. Be in love with your life. 5. Something that you feel will find its own form. 6. Be crazy, dumb saint of the mind. 7. Blow as deep as you want to blow. 8. Write what you want, bottomless, from bottom of the mind. 9. The unspeakable visions of the individual. Dean was in a trance. The tenorman's eyes were fixed straight on him. He had a madman who not only understood, but cared and wanted to understand more, and much more than there was. The tenorman wore a tattered suede jacket, purple shirt, cracked shoes, and zoot pants without press. He didn't care. His big brown eyes were concerned with sadness and the singing of songs slowly and with long, thoughtful pauses. His mouth quivered. He looked at us, Dean and me, with an expression that seemed to say, hey now, what's this thing we're all doing in this sad brown world? And then he came to the end of his song, and for this there had to be elaborate preparations, during which time you could send all the messages to Garcia around the world 12 times, and what difference did it make to anyone? Because here we were dealing with the pit and prune juice of poor beat life itself and the god-awful streets of man. He sat in the corner with a bunch of boys and paid no attention to them. He looked down and wept. He was the greatest. I had put the light out, so in the dark, dancing, I kissed her. It was giddy whirling to the dance, the beginning. The usual beginning of lovers kissing, standing up in a dark room. The room being the woman's, the man all designs. Quick to plunge, bite, put the light out, hide my face in shame. Make love to her tremendously because of lack of love for a year almost, and the need pushing me down. Our little agreements in the dark that really should not be told. For it was she who later said, men are so crazy, they want the essence. The woman is the essence. There it is right in their hands, but they rush off erecting big, abstract constructions. But I cannot in this confession betray the innermost, the thighs. What the thighs contain. The thighs contain the essence. Yet though there I should stay, and from there I came, and will eventually return, still I have to rush off and construct. Construct for nothing. For Baudelaire poems.
This is just his bones here. His spirit's around us.
Years ago, we were put down for being filthy beatnik sex commie dope fiends. 16 years later, Alan's the respect of his elders, the love of his peers.
Do you have nostalgia for the 50s and 60s, Alan?
Not at all. It's more interesting now. I mean, it's the same. I mean, it's all the 50s, 60s, 70s, same thing as now. It's eternity all the time, so there's no point having nostalgia for eternity.
Bill's ever Bill, even though he stopped drugging and smoking cigarettes. Me, I'm still considered unwashed beatnik sex commie dope fiend. The audience. We early heads of present style and consciousness are the daddies of the age.
Burroughs, Kerouac, and Ginsey are accepted in the literary
style. On the contrary, Gregory.
The point is, those three were the big ones, and if you, anybody afterwards...
Oh, yeah. Yes. Well, that's all right with me.
Yeah, right. But it ain't all right with me, because they were the only way to place me. I had my book published before his.
Gregory, you seem very bitter, and...
Bitter?
Your poetry and your work is so joyful and happy.
Bitter, I'm not a bitter man. Bitter? I bet my palms top all your shots. Mm-hmm. Watch the game, you don't even know what's going to happen 80 years from now. These fuckers may be in the ante.
Alan died April 5th, 1997. He said to me, I thought I would be terrified, but I'm exhilarated. His last words to me. Larry was another. I talked to Tim the night of his death. He said, why not?
I saw God in the sky in the form of huge gold sunburning clouds above the desert. Seemed to point a finger at me and say, pass here and go on. You're on the road to heaven.
We're the source.
What is that feeling when you're driving away from people and they recede on the plane till you see their specks dispersing? It's the two huge world vaulting us, and it's goodbye. But we lean forward to the next crazy venture beneath the skies.